I'm not saying I'm going to rule the world or I'm going to change the world, but I guarantee that I will spark the brain that will change the world, and that's our job.
JB, what's the name of the podcast?
It's a pod named Kickback. A pod named Kickback. It's like a Tribe Called Quest.
You say the whole thing. Welcome back to the almighty pod named Kickback. I am no breaks, new to righteous wretched. If you throw it, I'll catch it. If you got it, I'll match it. Each and every week, we right back at it. I am the Black Savage, the Magneto of my people. I love black women. Let's go. Jacq?
Hey, y'all. I'm Get Fit with Jacq, getting them waist snatched. So come holler at me.
There it is. The Randy G. Talk to the people.
I need to get fit with Jacq. You know what I'm saying? Get my six-pack ready for this summer. But, hey, it's your man, The Randy T. Man up. Monday all day. That's where you find me. Let's go.
Man, we got a very, very special show today because it is a whole fucking lot to unpack, man. It is a whole fucking lot to unpack. But I do want to start off by saying, let's see. Dang, I lost my train of thought. I do want to start the podcast with high and low. I guess let's go there. Let's start with the high and low. And this can be a good one. My energy a little, but I'm about to bring it back up. I'm going to get my energy back up. Jackie, I was out there doing my 3 miles in the damn scorching sun. That Georgia sun just melted my energy. But I got it.
It's melting those toxins.
Exactly.
There you go. See, that's what you need to hear. That's what you need to hear.
I make it all worth it. What the hell is the high and low? I'm tripping. That sun got to me.
Now, high low. Who wants to go first?
All right, real quick on the high and low, I started. My high is my business is officially a year old. It's a toddler now. And what that means for me, that drastically changes my percentages and my splits. So I am now in a position to really make the money that I've been wanting to make. And I expect the rest of 2024 to be so lit, so lit. Can't wait for Costa Rica. That's going to be so lit, so lit. And
Man, Jacq ain't getting no invite to Costa Rica, but go ahead.
Hey, they paying for me. I ain't paying for it. But I got to pay a little bit once I get there. But, you know, the company is it's on the company's tab. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
But I tell you what, though. We are going to do a podcast trip maybe next year. Maybe not this year. Maybe next year. We're going to do a pod trip. We got to go and do a podcast out in Valley some damn way or something. My low of the week, I don't really, really have a low. I would have liked to have worked more this weekend. And in the back of my mind, I'm like, you know, you should have worked a little bit this weekend. So that might be a low because that little voice in the back of your head, like, you should have worked a little bit. But other than that, I mean, life is good, man. Jacq?
Okay. Well, my high, of course, was what's up, Clarissa? My high, of course, was my daughter's last day of school. I have a fifth grader now. I'm very proud of her. She stayed on the AB honor roll. Very proud of that. Oh,
sucky ducky.
Interchangeable high and low.
Okay.
So, of course, the highs, of course, is Mother's Day. And, of course, my mother's birthday is on the 21st. But my low is just missing her. But my high also is I've enhanced my coping skills to where I'm able to deal with it better now than I have before.
That's big. That's big. And we talked a lot about that last week. Me and Randy had to hold it down by ourselves last week. But we talked about that and coping and, you know, different birthdays, different holidays, different years, and how every year is different. And how grief affects different people different ways. And just you have the right to deal with it how you are comfortable in dealing with it. This Mother's Day was the first one that I didn't really break. You know, and this is ironic because I lost, of course, my mother, but then my aunt that adopted me lost her too. So that was last year. So I was very surprised that I handled this Mother's Day well. So I understand what you're saying. I feel that as well. And then with Randy and us losing our grandmother last year as well. So, yeah. Randy T, high low.
Hey, I'd say my high this week, I'm going to get my low first. My low is first that last weekend, by surprise, I don't know if they coordinated this or not. And if y'all watching, you know, this just how I feel, all right? My neighbors all, like, on right and left side and across the street all decided they was going to redo their front yards, right? So everybody, they putting rose bushes and tulips and, you know, they got you know, contractors pulling up and doing stuff. So
you need me exactly to come help you?
So all this get done, right? And then my yard, so now my yard looking like the Section 8 yard now because, you know, all my mulch is, it ain't brown no more. You know, my flowers half dead. My flowers dead. Ain't no blooms on them. All the flowers on the bushes gone. So it's just three sticker bras standing out there. Right? I'm like, yo, like, I'm like, but still, like, if y'all watching, like, why y'all ain't tell me this last weekend was the weekend to do the front yard? But anyway, so that's my low. So I had to go a whole week. And I like they driving past. I hope Bing didn't do the overhead picture. And then my house looking like, what happened here? Like so today. So my high today though is give me my green thumb. I went out there and did it and did my whole front yard. I planted two new flowers out there as well. You know what I'm saying? Put the two new flowers. I'm gonna put pictures in the group. Hey, y'all who follow us, new gonna upload it to see. I'm gonna get the before and after. I was out there for 3 hours putting it in, getting in work, and my yard looks great. Now I'm up with everybody else. Section 8 is gone. Give me love, y'all. Give me love.
Good job. Good job. I thought me and Jackie was glad to fly in town and come help you, but you already got to take care of, so.
I know. Hey, next year, though. Next year. This every year. This every year. Okay. This every year. So next year, you know what I'm saying? Let's do it.
Pod, that's where you at.
All right, y'all. Y'all ready? What'd you say, Jacq?
No, I said we're going to have the podcast where he at.
Boom. Boom.
Right here. Right here in this basement. It's a whole section. Like, go all the way around. We good.
All right, y'all. I want to shift gears. This is going to be a good episode. It's going to be some good energy. We're going to have some fun. But we do have some serious shit to talk about. So I just want to set the tone for this serious shit. And then we definitely can get back to the laughing and the jokes because that's the mood we in, goddammit. Life too hard to be all mad and sad and frustrated. Right. But right. You have to address some real shit. And then we're going to have some fun. But
my left stroke just went viral.
Our viral story of the week here on the Pod Named Kickback is Diddy. The video of Cassie and Diddy from a hotel room in 2016. And I mixed this in with the court document so I can give the full story. There was an argument between Cassie and Diddy. Diddy was allegedly very intoxicated. He punched her in the face. And then I presume went to take a shower or what have you. He notices she runs out the room. She's trying to leave. That's where the video picks up. The video picks up. She's running down the hall trying to leave. He catches up to her, slams her on the ground. She lays there lifeless. So I don't know how hard he slammed her, but it knocked the wind out of her or something. Then he's kicking her, stomping her, pushing her. He grabs her and drags her back into the main lobby. Then the footage, there's an edit there. And then it just shows him picking up vases and stuff off of a table and just hurling them at her. And then it shows him dragging her again, which we assume was back to the room. That video was very, very disturbing to me for multiple reasons. I've seen the Ray Rice video. I thought that was horrible as well. And we know Ray Rice's football career ended after that video where he punched his fiance. This was more disturbing than that to me because this took place over a period of time. There was times when he threw on the ground. There was a break. There was the kicking and stomping. There was a break. There was more dragging her along the floor like a lifeless rag doll. There was a break. Then there was him throwing vases and shit at her. Then there was a break. And then he's dragging her some more. And allegedly, the first punch would happen off camera. So this was a woman who was getting her ass whipped, presumably that night. And it was very disturbing because you can wig out and maybe do some crazy shit. I don't know if you can wig out and punch somebody, but you can wig out and act the ass, blackout, and not know. That was a blackout. That wasn't a blackout where you catch yourself like, what the fuck am I doing? That was a thing where it was repeated, merciless onslaught of attacks on this very, very petite woman. Now, she was a big, strong woman. It wouldn't make a goddamn difference either. But just to paint the picture, or just to show what where my mind went, this was a little teeny young lady, little pretty little girl, and you beating her. Like, I've been in fights with niggas, and they fail. I didn't stomp the nigga. That's a grown man. You give a courtesy, like, get back up, we're going to finish fighting. You know, it ain't hatred. It's just, we gotta handle this. That was a woman that he was stomping on the ground like his mortal enemy. And again, it's niggas who don't get stomped out. In the middle of a heated fight, you might wait till he get back up to finish the fight. And he's stomping this woman. It's wild, man. My mother was the victim of domestic abuse prior to me being born, but I know about it. And I just have there's a spot there with me that it's disturbing. It makes you want to be Superman. It makes you want to put on your cape and go help everybody, which is impossible. And Diddy denied everything. He denied it. And we'll get into his fucking apology, but to see it on video is much worse than, of course, reading it. And now, Jackie, I want to throw it to you as the lone lady tonight on the show. Just get your thoughts, how you felt when you saw that. What women were saying.
My thoughts wasn't the focus on Diddy when I saw the video. What I saw was a woman trying to get away to the point where you didn't have any shoes on your feet. You're covering yourself because you're humiliated. You're embarrassed. You're trying to get away as fast as possible. And it's just moments that I see where she almost thinks she's going to get away, and here he comes. I don't think he knocked the wind out of her. I look at it as if that was a surviving mechanism. She bought up on the floor, and if you don't think that is confirmation, go to the other video when he had it on the patio. She had a blanket over her. She's balled up. That's to protect yourself. This is normal. This is what he's been doing to her. So when he did that, she went into survivor mode, and she covered herself up, and she tried to just lay there because just coming from that and having experienced that, that's what you do. You just don't want to give that person a reaction to even hit you or kick you even more. And that's what she was doing. That's why she didn't fight back. That's why she laid there. So I saw things like that being dragged back. I can only imagine her heart just like, damn, I'm trying to get away from him. He finna drag me back. Now I'm finna get whooped even worse because I tried to get away. So that video triggered a lot. And I'm sure it has for a lot of men and women that have gone through that. And like I said, just, you know, in our chat, you know, seeing stuff like this, a lot of people always question, you know, why she spoke up now, or with anybody, with any situation. Why are they speaking up now? Why they must want some money? Because, again, when this first came out, the blogs were just, oh, she wants some money. Oh, she wants some money. Cassie has been very quiet ever since this all happened because she already knew this video was out there. But again, that's why a lot of people, society, that's why women don't come forward. That's why men don't come forward, because we always get shunned. It's, oh, it didn't happen. What did you do? How did you provoke it? So it makes you feel like you don't even want to speak up because nobody has your back and we don't feel protected. So a lot of us out here have to start with ourselves. If you see something, a brother, a cousin, dad, a nephew, anybody doing that to a woman or a man, say something, do something, talk to that person, counsel that person, because that's what they need. But they might not see it as a bad thing if they grew up around it. They might think it's normal. So we have to really, like, you know, do a lot of self-awareness, tap into ourselves, and just do better as a whole as society, because this world, we've damaged this world enough. And that's the only way we're going to start is with ourselves.
That's 100. Randy T.
Hey, I agree with everything that Jacq just said, and echo all her sentiments. I want to preference all this and saying that, you know, still prayers and thoughts are still going out to Cassie, because with this video being released at this time, and now it is the talk of every newscast. So for her, she has to relive this over and over again. And me myself, you know, I've been raised by all women. I was raised by women, right? So shout out to my Aunt Lynn, to my Aunt Barbara, to my Aunt Elaine, to my Aunt Kathy, to our aunts. And so I'm saying that, and me, Ma. So, and my mother as well. So all of those women, right, helped raise me. And so I have always, so being raised by women, I always gravitate to their side, right? And sometimes even to my own detriment, but that's where my alignment lies because of the way that I was raised. With that being said, you know, it was a terrible thing that happened, right? And, you know, it's no way to justify what occurred. You know, I like that was for us watching. It was probably a minute of like video, like, oh, that's bad. But for her, like, and New, you helped me put this in perspective today when me and you talked offline about it a little more, is that that probably was, and I take it back to when I was in a car accident and the car flipped over. It flipped over in like 10, 15 seconds. It was a wrap, right? But when it was rolling, it felt like it was a lifetime. When I tell you, like, your life flashing before your eyes, like, I can think when the car was flipping, I was thinking like, oh my God, this was, and I was in Europe at the time. I'm like, man, I'm gonna die in Europe. I ain't gonna never see my son. Like, people, like, all these thoughts going through my head of thinking that I'm going to die, right? And you're thinking, like, how I'm having all of these coherent thoughts, right, about my life in a span of seconds, right, that the car flips. So when, and this, again, when me and you talked about it, dude, then I thought about it. I was like, wow, and I equated it to that. And I was like, think about the time, like, that was terrifying, that for this whole time, like, we caught the video starts is part two. That's what people don't even realize. Well, the part that's being shown to us now is part two, right? And you hit me on that too. That, like, I didn't realize that this was part, she was trying to escape because part one had already happened. So this is like a horror film. And, you know, the transition, you know, I teach a youth group at my church on third Sundays, and I wanted to hear the teen perspectives of it, right? So I brought it up in class this morning and to see how they felt about it. And the interesting point was, and our class is mixed, that we have, you know, young ladies from all nationalities in our class, and men too, which, so it was a diverse crowd, right? And so the interesting point of it was that when I brought this up, that they, the young women, said they echoed the sentiment that they said they feel like in their family they're protected, but in their community they're not, right? And then the young men on the flip side said that they feel like culture pushes them to disrespect women. Right? This is not my opinion. I didn't say that. Right? But this is I'm talking to the young people, and this was the consensus of them, and the young people are our future, so we always got to know where their mind's at. right? And yeah. So the fact that the young women now though feel unprotected, this is a problem. And all every woman in every nationality echoed the same sentiments that they said they feel like culture does not protect them. The protection that they feel from men only comes from the men that know them and love them. That's a problem.
Absolutely. I take this back to something a little different. When we were talking about the bear, women saying they feel safer with a bear than they would a man in the woods. I understand the sentiment and the reason why that offended me, and I don't want to go too much into this, but the reason it offended me because women don't feel safer with bears. It's a lie. What they're saying is, I want to point out how fucked up y'all men are. I want to point out that y'all are so foul that the danger is so real that I would damn near choose a bear. But nobody's really choosing a fucking bear. It's a wild animal. Nobody's going to choose a bear in real life. But this justifies what women were saying. This validates it to a degree. Like, that shit had to feel like, you said, like a horror movie. She's just trying to escape. I've seen the Jennifer Lopez enough, the white girl from Pretty Woman. She was in Sleeping with the Enemy. Julia Roberts. I've seen these movies where women are trying to escape these abusive men and they keep finding them. But this also adds to Diddy shouting Cassie out when he was getting those awards a year or two ago. He had the awards show like, I want to dedicate this to Cassie. I know you gone or you this. That's like a form of abuse. Your abuser is talking about you on TV. Don't say my name. You know what I'm saying? It's a shout out, but you don't shout me out. All the songs that he was doing, get in my bag, stay in my bag, now I gotta let you go. I heard that song, it made me think about an ex. I gotta let her go too, motherfucker. But it wasn't a woman I was beating. You know what I'm saying? Like all those songs, and you're in your house and you're chilling, you're casting, you hear that song, it's gotta give you the chills. Like, just stop fucking with me. I'm gone, I'm married, I'm over here. Leave me alone. Don't say nothing about me, don't mention my name. Right. Don't do nothing, just stop. And I remember I came in here and apologized to Cassie a couple months ago because I was like, oh, all she wants is money. I had no idea what the New York law was and how it had been extended where up to 25 years you could do a civil suit. So because it's outside of the statute of limitations, which is why they can't prosecute them in L.A. The video came out outside of the statute of limitations, yeah. I was like, something don't sound right. So it was outside of that realm. And so she did really the only option she had. It was either leave everything alone and never do nothing or take advantage of this 130-day window. So I'm glad she got the money. Before we get into his apology, I want to throw it back to you, Jacq. Anything that you want to add, anything we said that sparked the thought?
We just need to protect our Black men and Black women, all women, all women. We just need to have respect for each other. We need to that needs to be a more focal point than love. We see where that's gotten us. We see what the society looks like now on everybody's trying to be in love or don't want to be in love or whatever. But we got to have respect because you'll respect somebody. You cannot like somebody, but will respect them. But you can love somebody and do them any kind of way.
Yeah, that's like
we just gotta enhance our.
I agree, and we're gonna actually talk about that in the kickback conversation. That's a hell of a segue, but I don't want to go away from this just yet. I want to see exactly Clarissa. I was talking to Clarissa earlier. She like the podcast insider because we was definitely talking about respect earlier. But I want to go back to some of these comments before we get into the apology. Do you think he behaves this way because he had a concrete history of getting away with so much? I think that, to a degree, I get away with a lot of shit too. Now I don't mean I'm going to start beating bitches' asses because I can get away with a lot of stuff. I don't have to study and I can pass a test. I don't have to do my best and I can make some money. I get away with a lot of half-assed shit sometimes. I'm trying to get that out of my system, but I do get away with a lot of shit. That doesn't mean I'm starting beating people up. So I think that he did it because it's who he is. Now, was he flagrant about it? Like, wasn't making songs like I beat bitches. He wasn't doing anything to draw attention to that behavior. But I do think he was doing it repeatedly because he had no consequence. You know, if he hit a woman one time and he go to jail, he might not hit a woman again. So I do think he may have continued to do it because he got away with it. But that isn't why he started doing it. He started doing it. Usually when men lose their shit with a woman, it's emotional ignorance and it's not having control, feeling powerless in a particular situation. And you resort to caveman shit. You resort to your basic, it's like when I used to want to fight all the time, it was because I couldn't control my emotions. I couldn't control the situation. Now I'm going to fight. It's a weakness. And for you to have that kind of attitude or to go there with women, I think it's just some sucker shit. Especially like little teeny pretty girls. That, like, come on, bro. Break up with them. What else do we, what other comments do we have here? Let's see.
Yeah, that's a good point, and I think what Don brought up a good point as well. But before I get to Don, yours, what you said is that when I talk to the young men today, one part of their comment was that as well is that they feel like as young men, you know what I mean, that culture does not teach them to respect women, right? Family does, but culture doesn't, right? And but sometimes, you know, I mean, it's unfortunate in some households that are single parent, that parents raise their kids on their beliefs rather than the truth, going to Don's point, right? Is that and that happens, but that's what we have to have bring back community. Again to your point, Don, is that's what we have to get back to, community. And with the group discussion I had this morning, I saw as a community, as a whole, we feel like culture has taken over how we should be acting in real life. Instead of following the truth and what's right, We rely on what culture tells us we should do instead, right? And that's the sad part about it, right? Because we not teaching what should be passed on, so we can protect. You know what I mean? So yeah. We can love and protect going forward. So it's hard.
That's the thing.
And parents. So I'm gonna stop right here. And parents who are doing a great job with that, who doing it, but it takes more than that, right? It takes, and the African proverb is it takes a village, and it's true. It's no one person or two people. Parents do their great job, but in all actuality, parents don't, sometimes people spend more time with people's kids than they do with their own, not just because they don't want to spend time with their kids, but life, school, job, all these other things. They in the presence in places in 8 hours in other people who are contributing to their life. And when they're young minds, they helping shape it.
Yes, sir. And when I look at, speaking to that point about the community, I was in a barbershop today and I was facing one way, so I couldn't see what was going on, but a little kid had just got his hair cut and the mother was talking to my barber, like paying him. And little kid was like, let me show you the something, something. Let me show you the something, something. And the barber was like, okay, boy. All right, man. Show me what you could do. Show me what you could do. And I saw him like jump or something. And I couldn't tell what he was doing. And the barber was like, okay. And I was like, what the fuck did he do? And the other barber was like, hey, little man. We don't do that. We're not twerking, little man. Like, and some people might be like, let the boy do what he want. But it hit me because, one, I didn't see what was going on. But two, the mother wasn't going to say anything, but he's in a barbershop full of men. And the men in there are going to say, you shouldn't be shaking your butt. Now, I don't want the LGBTQIA to be coming for me. Mind your fucking business. I'm talking to my people. But I love that he said that. Like, hey, little man, we're not doing that. Now, he get older, he decided he's a woman or he decided he wants to do whatever. Then, okay, cool, let him do whatever. But at that age, you 4 or 5 years old, we don't need you twerking, young man. I don't know what videos you're watching, but that's to your point, Randy, where the community steps in. Some he don't know that little kid. That was a barber over there. But he saw right. that and was like, oh, no, nah, we're not doing that, buddy. And to Akul's point, What's crazy is the other girl who went on Tasha K described a similar ass whooping. She said he stomped her too. Yeah, she was pregnant. That's one of his actual baby mothers, I believe. She's actually pregnant and was pregnant with the child when she said that Diddy stomped her. And that was just like, just crazy.
Hold on.
Meek is a former co-host on a Pod Named Kickback. Shout out to Meek. She said, yes, the parents aren't their only children influence. That's very true. And like, I didn't have, you know, the best family structure. I had to learn on my own and learn from older niggas in my neighborhood and shit like that. But I don't want to keep picking on Fantasia because I use this example every time, and I'm going to toss it back to you, Jackie. If you don't, Fantasia didn't know how to read from, you know, birth to 14, 15, okay, that's the parents' fault. When she's 18, 19, 20, it's your fault. At some point, you got to figure shit out on your own. You have to, it is on the community, it is on the parents, but at a certain point, it's on you. So if certain things you haven't learned, it's on you to go and learn them. And I can never be a party to that, where we're just taking the onus off of everybody, because figure it out on your fucking own at some point. And I do mean it that way. And that's why I try to give back. Why I have so many nieces and nephews who ain't even related to me for real, but just people I see that need some encouragement, need a word, need something. Before we wrap this up, I want to send it back to you, Jacq. Any final thoughts on this?
No, y'all pretty much covered everything. I'm ready to get in this dumbass apology.
Right. So Diddy apologized today. Said he's disgusted with himself. He was fucked up. He was at a low point. He's trying to be, you know, a better man. He doesn't want forgiveness. He's been in therapy. And all of that is well and good, Diddy. If you wouldn't have denied all the claims and acted like everybody was lying on you, and now that this video proves you're sorry. I recognize the behavior, man. When you're caught, everybody's sorry when they're caught. But are you truly sorry for what you did, or are you truly sorry that you got caught? And I'm not going to say I don't accept his apology, but I don't. It's almost too little too late. If he came out at the beginning of this and said, look, man, I did some things I'm not proud of, and I don't want to discuss it. I've worked on it on my own. I've been in therapy. I've done the work. I'm a better person now. It's up for you. Fuck you if you agree. Fuck you if you don't. But I know I'm doing the work. I know I'm better now. And I'm sorry for all the fucked up shit I did. And that was a long time ago. That ain't me no more. If he had said that day one, I would have been like, that's fucked up you did that. I would have kept my same judgment. But okay, you've been in therapy. You did something. For you to come out at the 11th hour like, I'm disgusted with myself. Hang on, I too little, too late, man. But Jacq, the apology. What you thinking?
I'm just gonna say one thing. If the video didn't come out, we never would have got an apology.
Boom.
Facts. Drop the mic. You said drop the mic on. You said drop the mic on that joint right there. Hey, look. When I heard it, I was sort of like, this kind of like you get like your girl getting caught, like you getting caught cheating, and then you like, I'm sorry, yeah, and then you want to explain everything, right? Like, after the fact, you know what I mean? And I agree with you, Nu. Like, it's like now it seems inauthentic. I can't say that he does not mean everything that he's saying and that it's not true. I can't judge him and say that he's lying and he's making it up. And somebody just said he got a good PR team. Carissa, right. It could be his PR team telling him who wrote this. You know what I mean? I don't know. You know what I mean? But I've learned enough from this whole ordeal is reserve judgment till we get all the facts, right? But on this one, like, it seems inauthentic because of the timing, right? Because of the timing after it, like, I feel like your PR team should have told you just shut up, because now, like, anything that you say, again, you contributed more trauma to the person that you did this to. Like, because now you got a video circling around with your apology, And she already got a video circling around with what you did to her. Now she got a video circling around with you trying to undo what you did to her. Right. So, you know, there's no telling how mentally like she might be taking that, and her family has to deal with that. You know what I mean? It's like, just be quiet, man. Like, go the away.
The nigga spent $50,000 on that video and kept it in his house. So when they raided the house, they found a video. If it was me on that video, that shit would have been destroyed. But you know what? His sick ass might have been watching that video. Why would you keep video evidence of you doing that? If you paid to have it taken away in your possession, why the fuck are you keeping it? Dumb criminals. Always return to the scene of the crime. Always keep evidence of the crime. Fucking idiot. So, cool, right? We don't even know what other videos are there, what else is coming out. Diddy, man,
Gonna come out, gonna make us think any better of him than this.
It's nothing.
Or worse.
It could be worse. Yeah, at this point, you the devil, man. And I don't know how you get redemption for this. I think you have to dedicate a very large portion of your life to helping women in domestic violence situations. You need to make up some shit. You need to come up with Diddy's House, where it's a safe haven for women. You need to do something you have to put more good back into this world because of what you've done. You got to add more good. And if not, I don't consider you a loss.
Yeah.
I'm not real big into cancel culture after when I canceled R. Kelly all those years. I don't cancel nobody. I just listen to what I listen to and don't what I don't, and I mind my business. So I'm not saying I'm canceling Diddy, but I'm not in the mood for Diddy. I won't be in the mood to listen to no damn Diddy shit for a long fucking time. And I do want to say one thing before we close this chapter out, or this segment out. The minute the video dropped, I saw a post on Facebook that said, I just saw the Diddy video. That shit crazy. I'm going to still listen to all this music, though. I don't care. The sentiment that, like I said, I stopped boycotting R. Kelly. So people listen to whatever you want. I'm not trying to judge people or shame people. But the fact that the second that video dropped, your first initial response is, I'm going to keep listening to the music. It's either you're trying to be controversial, you're trying to ruffle feathers, or you're just a fucking idiot. It's like, learn how to read a goddamn room. The most important thing you took from that video was, I'm going to keep listening to the music. It's like, if that's your contribution to the conversation, shut the fuck up. I couldn't believe I saw this. Somebody I know. Somebody I've let come on this podcast before. You'll never bring your fucking ass on here again. I couldn't believe that shit. That's your contribution to the conversation?
Oh, they ain't watching.
I don't give a fuck. If you're watching, I don't even want you watching no more. Like, that's so stupid. The level of emotional intelligence that is missing from that statement. It's like, my God, dog. That's prayers for everybody involved. Positive energy to Cassie and her family and everybody that's ever been affected by domestic violence, to the survivors, and rest in peace to the ones who didn't survive. And tell us, if you find yourself in a position where you have crossed the line, I would recommend seeking therapy now. If you felt that you could get that close to where you would put your hands on a woman, therapy. Fix that about yourself. And I feel like we need a happy song. Where your song again, Ray? I'm about to play your song. Cause
man, rock that joint. Million Dollar Baby. Bring it back. Hey, but y'all see my band? Love and protection all of y'all.
All right. I said it changed the mood, changed the energy, man, because I was getting mad all over again. But having said that, I want to get into what we alluded to earlier, but Jackie alluded to, what Clarissa alluded to, was the conversation of respect. Uh-oh, and here go Clarissa being a lesbian again. Speaking of beautiful women, let's let Jacq know how beautiful she is today.
Thank you, Clarissa.
Let me flag down, please. Wait, I'm coming to it. She done complimented Randy and Jacq and said, no, what am I, chopped liver? You know what? I'm a cook with some money. I'm going to block you. But the kickback conversation.
Don't get on the block.
The kickback conversation was respect. And how I feel that is the quickest deal breaker in a relationship. I've often said this, and I've ended a few relationships over the last couple of years based on respect. If I feel like, oh, you like my pretty legs? Ladies do love my legs, Clarissa. I must admit, I posted my legs yesterday in my Hoochie Daddy shorts online. And let's just say, I'm a leg survivor. My legs just went viral. We'll just put it that way. But I do... look at Randy hating. But respect, man. Respect, I think, is key. I've seen a couple different videos that kind of test on it, but I wanted to make sure we test on it as well. I saw one that says women value security in a relationship the most. That goes back to being protected. And I believe that men value respect the most. If we get into a situation where a woman I'm dating disrespects me, to me, the relationship is over. And I believe that if a woman doesn't respect you, that relationship is dead. You can fight all you want. You can kick and scream and holler and do all the great things. Once that woman loses respect for you, it is over. I don't even want a woman that don't respect me. I don't even want to be your friend. If something has happened and you don't respect me, whether it's because of your own perception or something that I actually did, then we just need to end it. We don't need to know each other no more. Straight up, once I feel disrespect has entered the room, my dick ain't gonna get hard for you. It's over. It's nothing I can do for you, baby. It's nothing I can do. You will and you must respect me, or you won't know me. It's that simple. Right. We can be in a situation where a disrespectful occurrence may happen, and you know, you might get out of pocket, you may be in your feelings about something, and you may disrespect me in a moment, and I'll correct you on it. But I'm not going to end the friendship, end a relationship over that. But if I feel the respect is gone, then the relationship is over. And that can manifest itself in how you speak to each other, how you treat each other, how you care for each other. And I do feel like that's how it should be. But of course, I can't speak to everybody's relationship. But that is what I call an immediate deal breaker. So I wanted to get you guys' thoughts on respect in a relationship, because I think that respect would have kept Diddy from kicking Cassie. You can't kick somebody you respect and they on the ground. Like I said, when you're in a fight with a nigga and he fall, you might let that nigga get up. Because, no, we're going to fight straight up. I'm not trying to kick you while you down. You know what I'm saying? I think respect is very important in every relationship. But I was speaking specifically about a romantic relationship. If I don't respect the woman, we can't be together. And if you don't respect me, I don't want you nowhere near me. Jacq?
Well, with respect, especially with the Diddy situation, he didn't respect himself. So if somebody don't respect themselves, they're definitely not going to respect the person that they're with. And I'd rather have respect than love, because to me, respect gives birth to love. Once you have that respect with someone, the love is going to come easily. It's going to flow. You can hate somebody, but you can respect them. You cannot know somebody, but you can respect them. So I would rather have respect than love. It goes hand in hand, but you have to have that respect first before anything else can flow from it.
Indeed.
Randy T, what's your thoughts on respect, man? I know Mr. Man Up got some thoughts on this.
Hey, so it's the way that this relates, right? So I think it all comes down to communication styles, for one, right? And you know, men, we like to be communicated to a certain way, and women do as well. That's why, like, our communication styles are different from the beginning. Like when women talking to each other, like they go in deep, they go details. Like women meet each other, they're like, how many kids you got, where you live, you know what I mean? Like, and they get in, if we meet other dudes, we like, what you do for a living, what you drive, You know what I mean? And so we that and that's our communication styles. But the same time is that we feel love is how you respect us. That's our love language, right? Our love, most men love language is respect. When you show me that you respect who I am, then that's how you show me you love me. You don't gotta tell me you love me. You know what I mean? Like, I don't have to ever hear those three words, but the respect that you show me will demonstrate your love for me, right? And then on the flip side with women, with some of them, the way that they connect with us is emotionally. Like, so show me that you care about how I feel is how they see we love them, right? When we respect their feelings, right? That now I respect and understand, acknowledge, and move in that lane to show you that my action align with my words or how you feel. So then it goes the opposite way, right? So it's both ways. So with men, if we don't feel respected, then we don't feel like you can't love us. So to new point. So yeah, you easy to cut somebody off because they feel like if you can't respect me on like a fundamental level, then it's no way you could ever love me either, right? And respect is earned. So at the same time, for any man that's asking for a woman to respect you, be respectable. Be in a position where she can look at you and look at your life and what you stand for and what you carry and what you about and can say, if she don't know you from Jump Street, just met you today and read your bio, I respect that. Be that guy.
I have told so many, where my round of applause at? Hold up, God damn it. I have told a lot of little homies that, like, you gotta be the kind of man women respect. You gotta be the kind of man women wanna be around. It ain't about, because I know a lot of dudes just try to nice guy their way into some ass, nice guy their way into a relationship. Every man on earth is, women have 40 men a day being nice to them. Just because you're nice don't mean you're going to earn her attention, earn her affection. It's about who you are. Are you a respectable man? What have you done? There's an old saying, it's like, there's a person laying down on the ground with a gunshot wound, and they're looking for a doctor. Can anybody help? Can anybody help? And you want to walk up going, I'm not a doctor, but I'm a nice guy. And I'm going to treat you nice. Can you operate or not? I don't care if you nice. Can you save the fucking patient?
I say that at a Holiday Inn, though.
You know what I'm saying? Can you save the patient? What have you done that would impress somebody? What have you done that would make somebody go, damn? You know, so yeah, I agree 100%, man. You do have to be the kind of person, man, that a woman will respect to demand that respect. And when you know you're that kind of person,
you can command it.
And right, and if they don't,
you only got to ask for it. It's freely given. It's freely given.
They don't give it, then you know who they are, and you don't take it personal because you know who you are. So like, you know you're a man of respect.
Indeed.
Right.
So when they don't get that respect, you just go, "Oh, I know who you are. I get it. You don't even know how to respect a real. You ain't used to a real nigga being in the building. You know what I'm saying? You're not used to a real man. I get it. God bless you. But I do want to say before we move on from this, because I'm keeping Randy charged with making sure I kept the time right and we didn't stay on anything too long. So before we move on, I do want to say respect is very important, love is very important, and beyond all of this, you should know your partner's love language. You should know how they want to be communicated.
Absolutely.
I'll tell a story real quick, and I'll make this real, real quick. A woman told her guy she wanted an apron for Christmas. And he thought, like, an apron is very basic. I'm not getting her an apron. So he went and got her this elaborate theater system, all these things, all the gadgets, everything you could ever want. She could watch all of her soap operas in surround sound on the biggest TV with all this shit, right? And when he gave it to her, he chests out. And she was just like, "Thanks for an apron." He's like, "Dog, an apron like $100. I spent like $4,000 on this shit. You talking about some fucking apron?" The point is, listen, respect your woman. Women, people don't care what you know until they know that you care. And get her what she asked for. Fellas, get the apron. I don't care what you think the better gift is. I don't care what you think, you know, she just be even better. She didn't ask for enough. She asked for an apron. You know what you should get her?
A really nice apron.
A really nice apron. And if you want to do all that other stuff, do all that too. But you
go all out on the apron.
You better make sure that that fancy ass apron is a part of that package deal. Listen to your woman.
Hang that on top of the TV.
Exactly. Now this, and doing stuff like that when you're really listening can prevent things like this from happening.
It's the mayor.
Yeah, I know that's me singing. I don't know if our new listeners know that. That's actually me on the track back in my rapper days. You know, back in my back. But our what the fuck story of the week. A wife finds out her husband had been having sex with her 15-year-old niece. So she alleges, she tells him, you know, to get in the bed, you know, she wants to, you know, tie him up and get real freaky tonight. He doesn't know what's going on. And unbeknownst to him, you know, she's giving him fellatio or whatever. And then all of a sudden it's, and he's trying to figure out what the fuck. She cut his dick off. She flushed it down the toilet so that they couldn't reattach it. She's been in jail the last 5 years. Since then, he has hired a legal team to get her out of prison. He loves her and wants to be with her. She loves him and wants to get back with him. And I do want to make a note. The age of consent in Brazil is 14. So the 15-year-old niece was not rape or statutory rape. It was consensual. He consensually cheated. It's a lot wrong with this. You shouldn't be fucking your wife's niece. And I know the age of consent is what it is, so I won't speak on other cultures, but that's still kind of crazy. And the fact that she cut your dick off and then flushed it, does he have a dick now? He couldn't get that one back, apparently.
Can't have one.
Did they give him a prosthetic dick or something? You cut my dick off. Maybe I would want to be with you, like, bitch. Ain't nobody else going to want me, so you better come back. But for him trying to get her out of jail, this all is the really the what the fuck story of the week. Randy, what the fuck, man? What the fuck?
Man, like, it's so many layers to this, right? Like, I don't even know where to start. I don't even know where to start with this. Jacq dropped out. She didn't want this. Oh, then she back. I'm like, Jacq ain't want no parts of this. She rolled out.
Like, y'all talking about cutting off. I had to go in and come. I had to go out and come back.
They're like, y'all talking cutting off dicks. I'm out.
Now she felt guilty. Like, well, that was your one time. Let me get about it. It's getting hot.
I'm gonna say this, and look, let me. Anybody who might be watching from Brazil, like, no disrespect. I was just raised different. And part of how I learned a lot of things about Brazil, my first introduction to Brazil and their culture, unfortunately, was through Pornhub. So I feel like everything that happens in Brazil happens. I just feel like that's the country. I'm sorry. Somebody from Brazil, like, inbox me and hit me to what is really like there, because my whole knowledge of is that everybody banging everybody. They either banging or fighting. The only thing that I know from Brazil is porn and MMA fighters. That's it. And a Jesus statue. Three things. No disrespect. If you're from Brazil, I'm sorry. No shade. That's just all I know. That's my ignorance. Inbox me. Holler at me. But that's all I know. So when I hear stories like this, again, so I was just giving y'all background. So when I hear stories like this about, and it happened in this country, I'm not surprised. I feel like it's par for the course, right? Because I was told, and I'm sorry, but somebody told me that I could go to Brazil and have a great time with a pack of Snicker bars. So that's just what I was told. I don't know if that's true. I've never tried it. But so when I hear this story,
hey Randy, Brazil is the Florida of South America. They the Florida.
Okay, so Florida, I'm sorry. So when I heard this whole story, nothing surprised me here. Nothing surprised me here because again, in Brazil, they either it's FNF, they either fucking or fighting. So like, if he can't,
that sound like Atlanta.
Yeah, he can't hit her no more. So like, he might as well bring her back. Like, what else you gonna do with your life? Like, you know. So it didn't. You're Brazilian. That's all y'all do down there. So you gonna either like be the next Conor McGregor, or you just gonna love this lady for the rest of your life. That's
right, Clarissa. What are you doing with the Snicker bars?
Jackie, jump in here, man. What are your thoughts on this crazy shit?
I can't say about this Snickers.
Google it.
It's disturbing. It's definitely disturbing. But we've seen it time and time again. Some of these women, they get pushed to that point, they slicing it off. So be careful out there, fellas.
She respects you. She ain't gonna cut your dick off, fellas. That's right. That's how respect's important.
Right. And no respect for the last part. She could not respect that man to cut his junk off.
She wanted it to go away. She didn't want him to be able to reattach it. That's malicious, dog.
He didn't put himself in a position to be respected. He hit her family member.
Right.
Like her niece. Right. Her young niece. Right. So you hit a young... Not only did... Like, I think most women... And Jacq, correct me if I'm wrong. Like, if we're in a relationship and they cheat with somebody who's younger than you, you kind of be like, I ain't condoning it, but I, you know, at least it was somebody, you know, you tried to get somebody was a little, you felt like might be a little faster than me or something or whatever, a little younger. So maybe I understand, hot girl, whatever. But that added to it, right? So it's like, no, you try to get a better version of me in my own family? Like, right. Slim, like, she's... You surprised? I'm surprised she ain't cut his nuts off too.
I'm gonna tell you, in the Middle Eastern time, what they do, they castrate you and leave your nuts. You know why they leave your nuts?
In your mouth.
They leave your nuts on your body, so you still have the sensation, but no dick. So you still get this, like almost a hard sensation. You still get horny, but there's no release.
I don't even want to hear that no more. Like, that's terrible.
Well,
what's next topic?
Yeah, we're gonna move on to our Don't Be Dumb Award.
So dumb. You are really dumb. For real.
Mitchell, shut your whole ass up and make some drums, nigga.
So, our Don't Be Dumb Award goes to a couple guys. Damn, black men, y'all have been fucking up on this podcast today. We ain't got nothing good to say about y'all niggas.
This whole week.
Kel Mitchell from Keenan and Kel was on Club Shay Shay this week. And we got to shut down Club Shay Shay. People going on there saying all kinds of shit they don't need to be saying. And he admitted that his wife got pregnant 2 times in their marriage by outside men. And he stayed for the sake of the children. I have called women dumb for staying for the sake of the children. I am going to call Kel dumb for staying for the sake of the children. What kind of, who you got to be to have your woman get pregnant twice by outside men and stay in that relationship? Now, I will admit, I'm a little more liberal with love than most. I do not think cheating is if we are in love and we are happy, you step out one night, I don't believe that's reason enough to end our life together. If we are happy and we have built a life.
Different.
Yeah.
Tell people you poly, so your belief is different.
And actually, before I was poly, I just don't think cheating is a reason to leave a relationship. Now, if you cheated multiple times, or if you fell in love with somebody else, that makes it a little bit different. But if you, well, now at our age, I mean, we ain't at 50. So if you cheating now, I'm like, God damn, like, what you doing? But when I was younger and we were young and kind of wild, if my girl had stepped out once, I'd probably be heartbroken, supremely devastated. But I don't think that's a reason to end a life if we've built a life together. If you just my little girlfriend and you cheated, then fuck you. I'll find somebody else. But if we have built a life together, and you stepped out once, That is not enough reason to end a relationship to me. If I'm in, if me and a woman are in love or married or dating, and I step out once and you want to end a relationship, that's not reason enough to end our life. That's how I feel, though. Poly or not, I just don't think that's a reason to end it all. However, if when you step out, you get pregnant by two other men and you carrying two other men's babies in my house, you have a fat stomach from another nigga in my house, that's got to end. It's got to end at that point. Liberal love or not, poly or not, something got to change. You're not walking around here with a big belly by another nigga.
You might not find out till the baby's born.
But he did find out. So that's the point. She told him. So that's, you know, that is the point. If you don't know, you don't know.
Yeah.
You know, then the whole conversation null and void if you don't know. But if I know, he said we ain't had sex in a year and you 4 months pregnant, I know. You know what I'm saying?
No question.
So at that point, it's like, I'm leaving. And I give him the Don't Be Dumb Award. Yeah, I give him a Don't Be Dumb Award because I'm like, you stayed? Like,
you having an unnatural allegiance to losers is not like you.
It's not like me, Jacq. Jacq, talk to us, Jacq. Because we can put this all on you. You're the woman, Jacq. You done went out, you married to this guy, you done got pregnant by two other men walking around the house with a big belly, and you ain't had sex with that man in 2 years.
Yeah.
Justify this for you on behalf of all women, right. Jacq.
I'm talk sitting back. Let me put you on a hot seat.
First of all, my opinion on this is...
No, you defend women, Jacq. Go ahead, defend them.
I'm not going to defend the women because I, for one, would not be in that position because I respect myself more than anything, so I'm not even going to do that. But people do what you let them do, what you allow them to do over and over again. They're comfortable with doing it. That's why it was done twice. I mean... you know what I'm saying? You stayed. So I mean, you pretty much show how for people to treat you. So her doing it twice is not a surprise because it was okay the first time. It's okay the second time. It'd probably be okay the third time. So I'm not like new. For me, cheating is a deal breaker because at this day and age, at this age, we've all dated. We know the rules. It's simple. I ain't got time. My cheating is a deal breaker because I don't have subsections of what cheating is and all that. Cheating is cheating. Period. If you don't respect yourself, don't respect me, I'm out.
Yeah, at our big age, I'm more like, yeah, we shouldn't be cheating at 50. Now we was 30, right. 40, you know, things happen. We old as shit now. You cheating now? We about to have to wipe each other's ass in a couple of years. We cheating. So nowadays, back in the day, I did not believe it at all. But Randy T, I'm gonna let you get the last word on this, man. What do you think?
I mean, Jacq said it, man. I agree with Jacq. You know what I mean?
That's all I gotta say. Shit is crazy.
it's crazy. I mean, I feel bad too, but you know, cheating is a deal breaker. You know what I mean? But you gotta like, I feel like you gotta be on the same page with who you in relations with, right? And that's why, like, I saw this on White Lotus, and I took it, and I was like, I'm stealing that. If I haven't seen, I think it was season 2 of White Lotus, where the dude said that I never lied to my wife. And I was like, wow, that's pretty freaking awesome. That, like, he was like, no matter what, he was like, yeah, we do all this, whatever. He's with his boy from college or whatever. He's trying to get him to do all this stuff. And he's like, yeah, I do. And I was wondering, because she called him, she walked in and he was jerking off on the computer. And like, she was like, what you doing? He was like, jerking off. And then later on, he told her, he was like, it never explained it. But like another episode, watch the series. It's on HBO. It never, like, 2 episodes later, he was talking to his man. He was like, I don't lie to my wife. I was like, oh, that's why he ain't throw the computer down and been like, nothing. You know what I'm saying? So I got that, right? So, but then I was like, that is some real stuff, right? And I was like, to wear that as a badge of honor to be like, I don't lie. And it's people probably on here watching who know me, who know that now I'm took that as a badge of honor. And I pride myself as the guy that don't lie in relationships, right? Like, you gonna always know where you stand with me, where I'm at, and what we doing. Like, I don't have no reason to lie, so I don't. And it's so liberating. So yes, all y'all dudes out there still trying to be players, I'm telling you, tell the truth. Women will, we talked about respect in another segment. They will respect you more, and then you give them a choice if they want to deal with your bull or not. I'm putting it out there. Exactly. So if you enter exactly in, don't be mad at me, because I told you the truth. You know what I mean? From the beginning, that, you know, I like you to tickle it before we get it. And, you know, so, that was extra sauce. I'm done.
I do want to add this. My life coach, rest in peace, Horace Harris, love you, miss you. He told me, because I prided myself, like, for my rapper days, like, I don't lie about nothing because I ain't scared. Like, what you going to do to me? If I say the truth, what's going to happen? Nothing. So I don't lie, and I walked around like I don't lie, and I wore it as a badge of honor for the bulk of my life, because I know everybody else can't say that. But what he told me was like, yeah, I see the pride in that, and you being so honest with these women, you telling them all of what you're doing, and you're not being secretive, and they all know you're dating other women, and you're just so real with all the women, aren't you? And they all feel good, huh? Good job. But how about this? All that honesty don't really mean shit when you know she's only going along with it because she loves you, because she likes you. So you're still hurting the woman, even though you're being honest. You being honest telling her you won't settle down, but you know she's still chasing behind you. She's still waiting, and she's still hurt every minute you don't settle down with her. So now it's your job to be responsible for her heart. Yeah, all super honest guy, big fucking deal. He burst my bubble. Big fucking deal. Pat yourself on the back. Now, you're honest, but are you being careful with her heart? Because if she loves you, honestly, you have to save women from themselves sometimes. And I hold that.
That's not my job. I disagree.
What my mentor told me is my job to protect a woman from herself. If she loves you to the point that she's putting up with all of your shit, to the point where she's hurt, she's hurting behind your honesty, and she's still following.
But she doesn't love herself. You. For one, she doesn't love herself if she's doing that.
Yeah, but a lot of times women ain't gonna leave if they in love.
But that's not for you to say. You cannot say somebody don't want to love, that don't want to say themselves. I'm telling you, that is an endless battle.
Come on, Jacq.
I can end the relationship going, I know you're never gonna end it. I know you're gonna put up with my shit. My philosophy used to be, when she get tired of it, she'll leave. I'm going to do whatever the fuck I want, and whoever don't like it, they will eventually leave. But now I feel like it's my responsibility. I do feel like I cannot just be dragging women along, false hope, false
pretenses. It's my responsibility to keep my boundaries. That's my responsibility.
Right.
That's it.
What Jacq said.
I'm on number on this one, but you know.
Like, keep your boundaries. Like, look, you can try. You can't say, look, man, 3-6 Mafia told you long time ago, don't save her. She don't want to be saved. Move on.
Okay, well, do y'all see what my name, what it says under my name? I love black women. If she isn't mature enough, emotionally mature enough to separate herself from me, I am not going to take advantage of that situation. I'm going to cut her off in hopes that she finds what she's really looking for. I am responsible for a woman that loves me. I am responsible for her heart. That's what I'll take on. Now, maybe everybody in the world isn't.
By you cutting her off, that's holding your boundaries. By you cutting her off, that's holding your boundaries. Right. That's not taking care of her heart. That's holding your boundaries.
So he agreeing
with us, right, Jacq?
Yeah.
Essentially. Man, go to the next topic, man.
All right, next topic.
We got him, Jacq. We painted him in a corner. He didn't even know he agreed with you.
Well, Don said we gotta get some applause for that.
That's a good one. That's a good one.
You didn't even know. He didn't even know.
No. Now we got to talk about Jackie's high school prom date.
Oh, gosh.
Darius McCrary from Family Matters fame. And I'm going to take it a little easy on him because shout out to Kelly Williams, who played Laurel on Family Matters, a girl that was Urkel was in love with. We grew up together. Kelly is Kelly fam. So shout out to her. I'm not going to destroy your co-hosts, but I am going to put them to the table. He was admittedly in a marriage with Superhead, and admittedly she was saying on Vlad she would leave. Wayne called me. I'm gone for a couple weeks. I'll be back. I'm gone for the weekend. I'll be back. And maybe they have an open relationship. I don't know what it is, but the way that she described it is crazy. If she had said we were poly, he was doing him, I was doing me, I'd go, okay, cool. If she had said, we have an open relationship, oh, okay, cool, whatever. But the way she described it was just like, we in this monogamous relationship, but I just go suck Wayne dick, and he got to shut the fuck up, and like he was a cuck. So I always was looking at him a little weird. Mm-hmm. And now, a trailer for OnlyFans page for Sydney Starr, which is a transgender man, or transgender woman, woman was born a man but now identifies as a woman. I think that means transgender woman. He's in the OnlyFans ad and it's alluding to that, like, they fucking. So when you join a subscription, you can see him fucking this woman with a dick. Mm-hmm. I don't kink shame, so if that's your thing, all right, man, that's your thing, you know what I'm saying? But this is a bad look to be. You know, a TV star, it screams desperation.
Is he a TV star?
Well, he was, I guess. But it screams desperation. It screams weirdness. It's just more weird shit. I'm so sick of these weirdos. It's more weird shit from a weird nigga. You know what I'm saying? He a cuck. He a cuck, man. That's what they called him. And this shit is just terrible, man. Like, I mean, to each his own, but it looks contrived. Like the little trailer, it's just like, ew. And the thing that makes it so bad is he was in a relationship with Superhead, right? And we all know she wrote the book about sucking dick. She wrote it.
Yeah.
Now he's with Sydney Starr, who famously lied and said that Chingy fucked her and ruined Chingy's career.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
you're with these notorious liars and whistleblowers.
He wasn't that great of a rapper anyway.
I mean, but after that came out, we never heard a song from him again.
That's true.
And Clarissa, she's gonna be a nap in therapy after this podcast.
Me too, Clarissa.
Me three.
I got therapy tomorrow. Matter of fact, I do.
So it is just like, what are you doing, Jackie? What's up with your high school boyfriend?
You know, the one thing I see about all these celebrity men that are trying to stay relevant and want to shock or get some clout or likes, they either release a dick pic or they're OnlyFans. So this is normal. This is normal. I don't think this is bad for him. He likes it. So, hey, he like it. I love it. This might be good for him. He's probably, trying to get more open about who he is.
Ah.
Okay. You can tell they used to date. She's sticking up for a man. It's like Meek Mill speaking up for Diddy. Stand by your man.
This gave me a whole new perspective on it. I never thought of it that way.
Right.
I'd say it like this, man. Like, and my former pastor, rest in heaven, used to say it like this. Money don't change people. It only enables them to do what's in their heart. Right? So when stuff like this happens, it's like, Slim, you just got a platform. Money gave you the platform to do what was really in your heart. So even if he had money or OnlyFans page, he'd be doing this somewhere for free with somebody from the block that we all be talking about that going to school with him and be like, y'all know like what they do, right? So he doing what it's out. And then now, the transition culture has made this type of behavior so acceptable now, right? So that you can, like, 10 years ago, Nobody, and it, you can't tell me that he would have thought of doing this when he was still doing Family Matters with Urkel and all the rest of them. Ain't no, it's no way. But the evolution of the Alphabet community, and no shade to y'all, I'm just saying that the progress that they have made as a community makes this type of incidents more acceptable, right? Though, yeah. So it gives it, I feel like it empowers people who had this in their heart to be like, I don't gotta be in the closet no more. You know what I mean? Like, let me just come out and do what I want to do. Right? And again, so, you know, look, yeah. I feel like, man, he ain't gonna get no better. Family Matters was the peak. That was the peak of what he was ever gonna do with his life. So, it's not, maybe this
you
is
never,
your...
You never know, though. He might suck good dick and that shit take off for him.
He could. Oh, speaking of that, let's go back to that. Cause we talked about.
I don't want to.
I want to go back. I got a comment. I gotta give my comment
on him sucking dick.
Can I get my comment on Karen? I'm talking about Superhead. I'm going back to Superhead.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I ain't talking about him no more.
Okay.
The Johnny is Superhead. We'll talk about her next.
Contribution to the culture. Because she brought that two hand twist to the culture.
So man, look, I'm going to tell you that any, like, and no disrespect to any female, because y'all see my, I love and protect all women. But if you're in a relationship and you have a desire to be good at fellatio, watch her videos. Let's move on.
Or just keep practicing.
And shout out to
Seth. No, I don't know. I don't want you practicing on me. Like, no. Like, where you going to practice at? On some? I don't want no man being practiced on. Like, no. Watch the how-to.
Whoa. Calm
she
down.
Has the how-to.
Calm down, cowboy. Nobody said practice on a man. Hey,
Carissa, her name is Karen.
Her name is Corinne Steffens. She wrote the book Confessions of a Video Vixen, and she slept with a lot of rappers in the industry. And they gave her the nickname Superhead because she really sucked amazing dick.
If you really want to see a great porn, watch her and Mr. Marcus.
Yeah, her is Mr. Marcus. What was her name back then? It wasn't Karen Steffens in the movie.
I don't know. It was Honey something. It was Honey something.
Honey. Yeah, yeah. Isn't it Honey, motherfucker?
Her joint with Mr. Marcus is
Mr. Marcus meets Honey. And she pretty much made this, you know, world famous porn star tap out like 3 times. Cause the head was so great, he couldn't even take it. And like, stop, you trying to make me come. Like, we're supposed to be doing a whole fucking movie. And you keep, you know what I'm saying, being amazing. Stop being so amazing. And she brought in the two-hand twist, jerk, suck motion. I think she invented the Gok 3000. And yeah, so.
Who knows, but many people have confirmed that she is super, like, nobody has challenged her title of Superhead. That's all I know.
I do know a woman. I know a woman that is. Okay, moving on.
If it's sports, if it's fashion, if it's music, if it's hustling, whatever, you're on a marathon, you know, so.
Speaking of amazing women, I want to give a big congrats to the one and only Nicki Minaj, who made history as the first female rapper to sell out 36 consecutive arena shows. Her Pink Friday tour also becomes the highest grossing tour by a female rapper in history, earning $67 million just from the first 34 shows. And it now ranks among the top 10 highest grossing tours by rappers in history at number 9. If Nicki Minaj is not in the top 10 rapper list of all time, your top 10 list is yours. All right, now let's get into some rapid fire because Randy and Jacq want to talk about transgender sex for too long, so we got to move on. All right, I really did want to get into this. I think I'm going to save it for next week. I don't know what's going on. But I'm going to save the praise kinks for next week. There's a new thing called praise kinks.
Save that for next week. Because I didn't even know about that. I had to read up on that myself.
Yeah. A young lady asked me, brought that to my attention, and I was like, really? Interesting. So we're going to save Praise Kings for next week. But what we're going to do is, while we got Jacq here, we are going to end this episode with our review of the season finale of BMF. We didn't do it last week, Jacq. They're going to wait for Jacq to get here. We're not going to talk about BMF because, you know, that's your people's gang gang. We wanted to make sure you were here. So we're going to, matter of fact, I'm going to give you ISO on Jacq. We're going to let her break down the season finale of BMF, and then we're going to call it a good goddamn night.
Things are getting heated. Things are getting heated. I was kind of sad that old girl died. I liked her. I was really kind of sad that she died. I ain't even going to lie, because I liked her. I think she brought a lot of, you know, I don't know. I just liked her. But anyway.
Oh, so which girl? Which one? Not the one I hate.
Yeah. She's talking about the dyke who got killed. Yeah. That's what she's talking
you
about.
You like her?
I like her character.
She's annoying.
I know.
She's been voted the number one most irrelevant character in the history of the Power Universe, in the history of shows and shit.
She's a good villain.
You like that bitch?
I sure did. I liked her. Because she wild. They can't control her, so she was all
you good. Having an unnatural allegiance to losers does not like you.
Jacq had her segment, man.
But now we're in the part of BMF where we're going to be hitting California. Because I think they go to California and then they go back to Atlanta. But they on top of the world. This is when they rise up before, you know, we anticipate the downfall. So I'm interested in the next season to see them at their highest point and then how, you know, all that came to where it's at now.
Now you just gave us a spoiler, Jackie. That's how we know you in BMF. That's how we know you part of them. Because exactly. It ended with them in Mexico. You know what I'm saying? We seen nothing about Cali, right? All y'all, all kickbackers, y'all heard that, right? That if y'all watching the show don't show nothing about what she just said. we saw Meech and then was in Mexico at the season finale. Yeah, he was right. I ain't think. I thought you was playing. I thought you was making this up the whole time.
If you know the BMF story, my true BMF fans, you know why I said Cali. So they'll see.
Yeah. Shout out to Blue Da Vinci. This is what I've been waiting for. When I fell in love with the BMF story, it was at this point, probably a year from where the show is. So this is when I started hearing about it. So I'm super excited to hear about the stories I heard, to see how that looks on the screen.
Yes.
The billboards, the world is BMFs, them hanging out with Puff. Will they have Puff in there? Right. You know, like they had Deion Sanders.
Will he still be in there? Is 50 going to edit him out now?
I don't know. These questions that need answers.
He don't care.
Is 50 going to edit out Jacqie?
You know what? Whatever.
You about to find out. I don't know. I guess we'll see. But at this point, they've taken over Atlanta. They got the Atlanta crews behind them. And Meech, Terry's kind of happy with the progress they made. And Meech is like, no. Every state. Mm-hmm. Georgia, cool. No, every state, though.
Right.
And Terry is like, dog. He like, yes. So now this is the takeover. So we'll see probably the takeover next season. I'm anticipating we don't see the celebratory BMF until the end of the season. In the next season. I think season 4, I believe it's what it'll be, will be the celebratory BMF season. I don't think this next season is the celebration. I could be wrong, because we won't be, because we know Jacqie know. So
right. No spoilers, Jacq. No spoilers, Jacq.
Yeah.
Hey, but I'm gonna say this too. And I know a lot of my Georgia people on here tonight in Atlanta and Macon. Meech reminds me of, and some of my people watching know this, his name was Carl Howard, rest in heaven. He was my boy. He was probably one of, like, he did Jeezy know him. He did business. He was one of his boys who died. And he was a good friend of mine. But when I am so hooked on BMF, because he think and talk just like Meech did. And he was a drug dealer too. But that's how his mind worked. He was a Georgia dude. And when I tell you, like, anybody who watching this will tell you that he was so ahead of his time. Like, the stuff that he was doing and buying. Like, you, when I see Meech doing stuff that he doing, I remember times, like, when we was, like, with Master P in places because of him just throwing money, you know what I mean? And they just acknowledging, and he just wanted to keep doing. Nothing was enough. Like, even when he made money and hitting thousand, it was never enough. When I see Meech, I was like, man, that is cold. That is Cole. Everybody making MacTown, y'all know Cole Howard. That's my man. Like, he thought just like Meech. Like, so every time I see it, I was like, man, it take me back. I think that's why I'm so in love with this show. Remind me of my boy.
Ooh, yeah. I just got a thought about the whole. So with Big Meech, the one thing I do see in the gift that I think that he has is bringing people together of all walks of life. He could definitely, like, he could help the industry. He really could.
Yeah, he do.
Look at that. You're advocating for me to be in charge of all the labels. She just still doing whatever she can to help her little boo out. Well, I swear.
BMF to her, she die.
Exactly, to the death.
Y'all so silly.
But next week, we're going to do a recap on X-Men 97. We're going to talk about Praise Kinks. And then whatever the biggest stories of the week are. But before we get out of here, the playoffs, I see the end of the first quarter. Denver's up 24-19 on Minnesota. This is game 7.
Oh, good game. Good
so
game.
So we're going to see how this goes. The Knicks lost today. Too many injuries. I do believe the Knicks could have challenged Boston in the finals, Eastern Conference Finals, if healthy. But too many injuries. I'm glad they didn't make it. I'm glad they didn't advance. They are too hurt. It would have been a waste of a fucking series to watch them, all those injuries, try to go against Boston. So I'm glad Indiana won because they're relatively healthy. They only had one major injury, and that's Benedict Mathurin.
They still gonna get swept.
Yeah. But you know, Boston like to let you in a little bit. So Boston
might get one game. Just because Jason Tatum gonna be confused the whole game. One whole game, he gonna be confused. They'll win that one.
And then the West, Dallas. I would really like to see Dallas. I would like to see Luka go against the Joker. The two foreign men that play that point forward, point center position. But I'm really rooting for Ann Edwards in Minnesota. So we'll just see.
Not me. Minnesota they need to learn some more. Like, they're going to be back. They young. They bad. AO is the next. If y'all don't know anything about or watching NBA, AO is going to be the next dude in the NBA. He's going to be like the next Kobe Bryant.
Why are you calling Kevin him A-O?
That's his name.
Anthony Edwards? There's no O.
A-E. I'm sorry.
Okay.
A-E. A-E. He's going to be the next dude. Look him up. He's 22, and the boy is a monster. He is a man at 22. So watch out for A-E. Minnesota going to be back. They're not ready, but like, they young. They hungry and they balling.
What I've noticed is the more veteran teams are still winning. All the vets are really gone, but out of the teams that are left, the veterans are kind of stepping up, or the healthy teams. I think the Knicks would have beat Indiana if healthy.
Yeah, without a doubt. Indeed. It would have been over. Indiana would have got maybe one game, maybe two. Two at the most.
Yeah. Looking forward to the Wizards being involved in about 3 years. Give it 3 years, the Wizards will be back involved. I want to thank y'all for tuning in. This is a Pod Named Kickback. Be sure to follow us on YouTube so you can watch us live Sundays at 7 p.m. If you subscribe on YouTube, you can watch us live and interact with us. If you're listening to this or watching this on Monday morning, you missed the live last night, but I hope you still enjoyed the show. Follow us on all social media. I'm at No Breaks New on everything, No Breaks NU. TikTok, Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, Threads, Christian Mingle. Everywhere you go, I'm at No Breaks New.
I ain't even a Christian.
Right. I'm just on there being nosy. You know what I'm saying? Follow Randy at Man Up Monday. Follow Jacq at Get Fit with Jacq. This has been another great episode, and we are under an hour and a half. We had an hour, 29 minutes, and 30 seconds. We're
doing good.
Make sure we get up out of here. Let me see.
You see this
Metro, shut your whole ass up and make some drums, nigga.
Joe Ford.
Hey, man, play my song. Play my
ride
song.
Out, you play play
my
play.
Song. Let's ride out to my song, Million Dollar Baby. Hey, y'all, download this joint.
So watch the video. See your bedroom, mama, see your tea, no matter what happens, even that color between us.